Henry Liu. He's the president of Max Solution. He's going to talk about the current 3D printing technologies and the machines and the future trends, all that, and also the application, right, in the industry. And also we're going to have Ethan. So Ethan is going to talk about, Ethan speaks, no, his Chinese is not as good as mine. So Ethan is going to talk about the courses, right? So how do we structure the training course in 3D printing? So those are the two speakers today. We also have a Brian. Brian has a tremendous experience in 3D printing as well. Okay, but you know, obviously for the first part, Henry maybe can do a bit bilingual.
Okay.
Right, I know some presentations are made in Chinese, but you can try to do some English. And okay, so I'm not going to stay here for too long. Right. Okay, it's your turn, Henry.
Okay.
All right.
Hello, everyone. Good evening. So my name is Henry. I'm the president of Max Solutions, and we do 3D printing business. And I started this business for like 2 years, but now it's become one of the largest ones in Canada. So I just do a step introduction at the beginning stage. So hopefully I can do like both English and Chinese, but maybe it's better to do English at this moment. My company is one of the top 3D printing companies in Canada. So we manufacture and sell all types of 3D printers. So we sell FDM 3D printers. This is ERP. FDM, and we also produce those parts for like industrial customers. We don't do individual at this moment. So we also do mechanical design, simulations, and we do 3D printing service. So before involved in these companies, I worked for this industry for 7 years. I did my PhD at Imperial College London. And after my PhD, I came to Canada to do my postdoc at UFT. And also, I do some consulting projects like OPG, Auto, or RR Huawei. And I started this business for 2 years. And we majored to the 3D printing. And now, the presentation I have is to tell you something about 3D printing, why this is a future technology. And the outline of my presentation includes what is 3D printing, 什么是三个打印, and 5 methods of 3D printing, the application areas, and why we need to study 3D printing. And also, if you have any questions in my presentation, you can ask me. So, and also, I can let you experience this 3D printers. So, let me begin. 3D printing, of course, it can be combined with 3D and printing. So all the parts you do the 3D designs, you can send to 3D printer and transfer to the readable format for 3D printer, which is called STL. And STL can be converted to a G code. So this is a path recording for 3D printing. So all the parts like this is designed by 3D design software. And we can, this is dual color. So we can design these two parts and combine in whole assembly and convert to 3D printing. And it can be just automatically printed and magic happen. So 3D printing becomes a big factory, so which is so different with traditional manufacturer ways. So that means all the parts you design by computer, it can be manufactured. So like traditional, for this kind of things, you have to make a very big block and cut it. So, but 3D printing can save a lot of time and also save the budget on the materials, on the design, and on the manufacturing. So 3D object is created by just print layer by layers. So this is called successive layers of materials, and it will be print the whole things. This is pretty easy. So like this, if you can design by iPad, by computer, send to 3D printer, and it will be print these things. So 3D printer currently has five technologies. FDM is the most popular one. SLA can produce very fine materials like this. So traditional technology cannot make it. It's one-shot printing. So that means it can be moved, but it's just a print at one time. 3DP is pretty interesting. I forgot to bring the samples for 3DP. 3DP can produce the color products. PolyJet is the most finest one. And SRS is powder technology, so which can produce metal nylons. I will just show you in the following step in the slides. So this is FDM technology. This is FDM. So FDM 3D printers is built part by melting the thermoplastic with the temperature around 200 degrees C. And the print nozzle deposit layer by layer in the building areas. So 工作原理 ,FDM 的工作原理是把加热头那个是加热头是叫 nozzle, 在那个使那个材料热溶性材料加热到了一个临界状态以后，然后它呈现了半流体的状态，所以说它可以跟着那个路径挤出来这个东西，然后一层一层的那个铺开，产生那个在电脑中设计出来的模型。这个技术基本上是个最成熟的技术，大概90%的个人用户会选择 FDM 作为他们的第一款的打印机。现在市面上打印机已经很便宜了，像这一款打印机那个在我们卖的话就是大概300多块钱，然后呢一些箱体的也就低于2000块钱，还有很大很大的，大概在三米左右的，大概在上万块钱，但是300块钱已经是一个很 affordable price 了。在过去几年的话，当我从事 3D 打印的时候，这个一个 FDM 的 printer 3D system 出产的，我的第一款 printer 是4000块钱。然后我想介绍一下，下面是 DLP and SLA technology. So this is DLP, and SLA is a bigger one. It's like bigger than half size of these rooms. So what the difference is the lasers. So DLP and SLA 3D printers is using the lasers to cure liquid resins into hardened plastic in a process called photopolymerization.This is very typical DRMP 3D printers, and it's around $700. SLA 工作原理是激光的光束通过数控装置，控制了按照设计的扫描器路径喷射到液体的光敏树脂表面。光敏树脂就是在 UV 的照射下，它会 solidify, 会固化。然后呢，那个这个是可以看一下这个平台。现在我没有放任何的树脂，因为放了以后很容易去倾倒。这个平台会上升这个是激光头会上升一段一定的距离，这样的话就会形成一个非常非常光滑的物体。像这些模型，可以传一下，这就是用 SLA 打印的。可以感受一下它的表面非常的光滑。而且它是一次成型，所以说传统的工艺没法做到把一个部件一次打印出来可以动的，但是 3D 打印是可以的，因为它会那个在不同部件之间留下一些间隙，会留下一些 clearance, 这个中间的支撑在打印完了以后会非常轻易的那个融掉。这款打印机是600块钱，然后呢，这是我们卖的一些那个比较 typical 的打印机，像这一款是 Formlab,
在北美市场的话还仍然卖3500块钱，像这种的是很大型的打印机，像我刚才说的有大概四分之一这么房间这么大，它能打印非常大的东西，但是价钱也比较贵，这是工业用品。在现在生产的一些空调啊那个冰箱啊，很多的关键部件是用的这个打印机打印出来的。下面是 3DP 技术。 3DP 技术的话是可以，它是一个那个粘接剂，是一个粉状的东西在 tank 里面，然后呢粘接剂抖下来，这样的话就把那个粉状的东西粘连起来，所以它的表面是一个我今天不好意思我没有带过来，那个是一个不是很光滑是有颗粒感的那个形状，但是它因为它有四个进出头就是 CMYK， 所以说它可以打印任何的彩色的东西。这个应用场景是比较的有趣的，就是大家的比如说大家在那个 3D 扫描机制这样走一圈，这样的话我们就可以知道大家每个人的脸部的特征，然后呢打印出来你的衣服的颜色啊脸部的特征，这样的话就会相当于自己打了一个自我的肖像，这个是最大的一个应用场景。我的那个公司有很多这样的模型。这是传统的，这个比较好的一个 3DP 的打印机，大概在8万块钱左右，是 3D Systems 的一个打印机。PolyJet 是一个最精细的打印机技术。可以看一下它的描述，它很像 3DP， 但是它出来的不是粘接剂，它是激光。激光过了扫过的时候，它会材料发生固化，它的那个表面是非常光滑的，跟玻璃一样的光滑，而且它这个技术比 SL 的话要快很多。像打印这样的一个东西，这种的打印机你可以看很慢很慢，差不多大概在2-3天左右，但是 3DP 的话半个小时之内就可以完成。可以看这个刷了一下就打好了，这是桌面版的 3DP 打印机，大概在8000块钱，工业版在2万块钱。现在这是现在的市价，但是过几年以后，这个价钱会有大幅的下降。当我从事 3D 打印机这么多年，我就知道，开始的时候的打印机的价钱会非常贵，但是现在的价钱也很亲民了。最后这个是 SL 技术，它是一个叫粉末点金技术，就是把。那可以看一下英文的说明，如果听不懂中文的话，这个就是在一个 tank 里面放了很多的 powder， 比如说像金属的 powder 或者尼龙的 powder， 也是激光扫过的时候会形成固化，这个就很神奇，因为它生产的是比较贵重的金属和尼龙这种打印这种东西，像现在这个技术已经应用于像大飞机啊那个汽车方面。它解决了应力集中问题，不像传统的锻造，它会产生那个很容易产生裂纹。但是像这个的话，就是完全取决于它的粉末的性能，它打印过来的话，它会非常的光滑，也会非常的平均，所以说它没有任何的应力集中，而且它比传统的工业要快很多。像一个飞机的机架。像中航集团设计的一个 SL 非常大的一个，大概有体育场那么大打印机，生产一下的话就是3天的时间，但是传统工艺的话要乘以10，所以这个是个最高端打印机，但是它价格也是最贵的，大概在40万左右加元，200万人民币左右，这是完全是工业化的，现在这种打印机还没有面向于个人。所以下面我说一下 the advantage of 3D printer。像我们传统的，像我是从事机械制造工程，制机械这个领域的，所以说我可能会对工业比较熟悉。我列举的这些东西，可能是我们专业领域了解的东西。他们像传统的一个模具吧，它从制造到修改大概周期是在3个月到6个月左右时间，但是利用 3D 打印的话可以直接生产模具，所以说它的周期会降到几周， 如果是我们的那个机器在空余的话，可能一两天就能生产出这个东西，这样的话它就可以非常快速的进入市场，而且设计师会根据他们的构想去设计任何的东西，他们不需要局限于传统的工艺。所以说它的这样的话，它的生产会降低很多的价钱。像现在越来越多的那个企业用 3D 打印去生产设计东西，就是因为他们的 budget 会降低很多，哪怕是去买一个大概在2-3万块钱左右的比较精细的打印机，但是它跟传统工艺比的话，一个模具就很贵，所以说他们的那个 budget 会降低。还有就是 mitigate risk， 减少模具生产的风险。像我们在机械领域的话，就是服务于模具生产商，去制造出更好的模型，然后呢让他们大批量生产。而且像第四点就是 clear communication， 我们做机械设计的时候，我们很不喜欢是跟加工人去交流，我们需要喜欢用图纸说话。 3D 打印的话就是会生产出一个比较好的图纸，不管是生产人员还是设计人员都可以很轻易的沟通。现在很多的像我们第五点列的是减少库存，传统的企业加工厂可能要买一个很大的地去生产，但是当那个用 3D 打印做辅助的时候，只要有订单的来的时候我们再去生产，这样的话我们可以减少很多原材料的成本，只需要存放几个 3D 打印机和 3D 打印的材料，我们就可以去生产。所以说把大的工厂变小，把它小的工厂变精。所以最后一点就是总结，因为设计师和生产和生产者他们更容易去交流，所以说设计师可以放飞自己的头脑去设计很多的东西。任何复杂的东西在都可以用 3D 打印来实现，这样的话我们可以看到很多一些比较独特的设计是传统工艺完成不了的，但是 3D 打印可以推向市场。这就是我后面介绍的为什么要学习 3D 打印，因为 3D 打印最主要的对于孩子们是可以放飞自己的想象力去生产，去设计自己头脑中想的东西，而不需要局限于任何的外部条件。Application areas， 我是学机械的， mechanical and modular designone of the biggest areas I have currently, and art is another one. Medical miniature size is for architecture and food. 像这个，我还是喜欢用中文说啊。这个 mechanical molding design， 这是我们之前给客户设计的一些东西。像这个产品是非常复杂的，就是用 SLA 打印出来的。还有像这种外壳的设计，这个叫 silicon molding， 就是说一个模型打印出来了以后，然后我们会生产出一些硅胶覆膜的东西，会生产出客户定的100个，然后呢我们用硅胶覆膜，一个硅胶可以覆膜大概20个，覆膜出来的是一模一样的东西。这是一个很小型的模具的一个生产过程，也非常 popular 的一种工艺，之后我们再进行定金，就生产出这样不同的鸭子。还有 art， 虽然 3D 打印的话很一般的 3D 打印技术都是生产出单一的模型，但是它的表面非常的光滑，基本上看不到任何层纹，所以说我们可以去进行涂色，涂成这种呢非常好的工艺品。像这个是弹性的一个项目，设计师花了大概2周的时间去做这个事情，但是当时是2年前做的，价钱还比较贵，大概当时我们要了是4000加元，所以说这个行业的话 profit is profitable。 还有这些玩具的，这是游戏公司的一些模型进行喷涂啊，上色就会生产出这种非常逼真的模型出来。所以说孩子去学习这个的话，学习 3D 打印，学习三维设计，可以进入游戏动漫公司这个非常好的行业。 而这个行业的话也是既有趣又能有比较好的收入。
Medical 这个我没有涉及，这是我们从网上找的一些资料。助听器和牙模是一个最大的领域，因为每个人的牙齿和耳朵的形状都是不一样的，传统工艺很难去做出相应的模型，三 D 打印是这个行业的刚需。还有这是一个心脏的模型，它是打印的细胞，这个是很比较高端的三 D 打印技术，
是一个专业领域的。
Size and miniature， size 就是我们正在做的东西。传统的像我说的 size 就是那种的灯箱，路上灯箱的话现在在加拿大还没有三维制作的，一般的灯箱都是用那个亚克力那个拼接出来的，但是 3D 打印机是可以生产出灯箱壁的，然后变成一个可变换式的灯箱接上，而且它的价钱要是传统的大概三分之二，比它便宜三分之二，比如说传统300块钱 3D 打印机就只有100块钱。不仅如此，我们可以生产出任何不同的造型。 Miniature 是一个我们会跟房地产公司去做一些 Miniature Design， 就是说他们给我们沙盘模型，沙盘公司有些很复杂的是做不了的，但是 3D 打印会很容易的去实现它。
还有这个是四组加推
这个第一个咖啡，这个是一个非常普遍的一个场景，它不是 3D 打印，它是一个二维的它平面的打印，但是可以把任何的照片输入到这个叫 coffee maker 里面，打印出它不同的花样。蛋糕也是一样的，还有包括奶油啊巧克力这些都可以用 3D 打印那个实现。加拿大很少有在做这个方面的，我了解的在 Yonge Street 有一家，很慢，但是这个打印机像 coffee maker 的话人民币是4000块钱，已经很便宜了，就是说基本上一个个人就可以去开展一项单独的生意，然后呢把照片输到打印机里面就会去打印出这个表层，包括奶油也是。还有就是这种饼干的模型，这个饼干不是 3D 打印打的，是买像这种的FDM 的 3D 打印机去设计出它的模具来，然后那么一扣就可以生产出来。我们有很多客户买了好几百台打印机生产那个。好，下面是我想介绍的是，这是刚才是一些 3D 打印的领域，大家有什么问题可以问我随时都可以问。OK， 好的我想因为这个是面向的是教育市场，我们是做专业领域的，我们没有面向没有教育，但是因为我在这个行业里面我也是很希望孩子们去开始去做 3D 打印。为什么呢？因为它可以提高孩子的创造力、思维力、玩随结合，而且这个 3D 打印是非常容易跟 STEAM 教育结合起来的。我下面有一些例子，这是我的一些想法，大家可以读一下，或者我读一下给大家。孩子创造力是孩子们的想象得到了很大的满足，孩子们的创造灵感得到了激发，其实是在玩中去学到更多的知识。还有思维力，因为 3D 打印更主要的是三维设计，孩子们在创造三维部件同时能用打印机进行反复的测试，用几天或几个小时而不是几个星期或几个月来进行模型化的尝试创作，通过 3D 打印的每一次建模，你就能学到什么可行什么不可行，然后再进行相应的修改和提升，以致达到最终的理想效果。玩学结合，我们的课程不是教孩子们如何使用繁琐的 CAD 的工具，Ethan 会介绍一些课程的设计，他们其实是一个非常简单的，孩子们比较能玩易懂的一个模型概念，就是相当于像搭积木的建模理念，简单有趣，简单上手，并且通过有趣的案例可以让孩子们能创作出属于自己的玩具。 并且这个是跟 STEAM 教育结合。
这个下面是我那个三D 打印教学的一些比较经典的分的阶段。像第一个阶段是5到8岁，就用一些三 D 打印笔去创造一些跟二维结合，创造一些三维的东西。像这个降落伞啊，这是我的员工做的一些产品。还有就是建模，这是一个非常非常简单的建模软件，但是可以通过各种几何形状组成，去做出比较有趣的模型出来。啊，这些是。这所有的模型是通过学习课程能掌握的，像比如说这种的小的风车小孩的模型，这是相当于是通过圆啊方啊这种几何堆积，但是把这个每个部件输入到 3D 打印机里面，打印出这种独特的但是又非常简单的有趣的模型。还有就是它可以跟传动结合，这是 3D 打印比较典型的汽车玩具，我不知道为什么 PPT 发不了。这个大概在10岁左右的孩子，而且像那个学校会开展一些 advanced lessons， 会教孩子们用专业的设计软件 SolidWorks， 这个是我们专业最基本的一个软件，还有艺术领域，比如像 Maya、Zebra 这些专业软件，当你们设计的话，会生产出真的是千姿百态的模型。这个是我建议18岁以上，但是这是一个成人教育，但是现在我接触 SolidWorks 是在16岁左右。最后是我们公司的那个网址，还有我们的微信号，因为我们是跟 LinkedIn Key 合作关系啊。那个今天也很非常感谢 Henry 邀请我们来进行这个讲座，这些是一些我们用 FDM 生产的样品，包括这是双色的，还有像这种扳手是可以动的，就相当于这种的很基本的打印机都可以完成的，到时候也可以过来参观一下，那个也可以传阅一下这个东西。
OK，
我们有很多的机器人是吧？
还有更多的吗？OK， 像这个的话，我们想送给孩子，这种小的机器人，能拿过来吗？打印出来的。这小机器人是？
那边就传回来。
像这个就是叫月球灯。这个是我们把照片映射到，其实是可以映射到任何的表面。比如说这是一个 Merry Christmas 模型，如果你们给我们照片的话，我们也可以做这个，就是做到这块，这是一个非常好的定制化礼物。其实 3D 打印适合的是个性化和定制化，每一个人都有不同的那个，比如说照片什么的，我们都可以做到任何的表面，不只是局限于球状的，只要是三维软件能实现的，都可以做到。还有这是我的名片，如果有需要的话，可以。那个拿一些。
OK，All right. So, we'll get the second part started. You said.
Yep. All right. So, I'm gonna talk 100% in English because my Mandarin / Cantonese is not that great. So, I'm gonna be talking about the course that we're gonna be running here at LinkKey. So, we plan to run 2 levels of courses. Here at LinkKey for students in both elementary school and high school. So the first thing It's a 3D design workflow. So this is really important to when you're designing things in 3D, when you're planning on making things, designing application solutions. There's always a problem for a solution that you're designing, and you have to go through a series of steps in order to get from an idea in your head to a, you know, an actual part. So the first thing is designing it. So you have to be able to CAD it. So CADing is computer-aided design. Henry spoke a bit about that, and how that all fits together. So how do you actually make the model on the computer? How do you know roughly what it's going to look like in real life? How do you design for different things, and what are design techniques? And then after that, we slice. So we're going to be using Cura for that. So slicing it is generating the G code, basically turning it from that 3D model into something that the 3D printer can read. And the 3D printer that we're going to be using is this one right here. It's Slingo Carapuza, and that's the printer that we're using. And then step 3 is print. And then obviously once you're done printing, chances are you're probably going to have to iterate. So whatever you print, it's probably not going to be what you want it to be. Maybe you find a spot where it could be better that you didn't consider. And then you're going to end up iterating, going back to designing, maybe going back to slicing because you sliced it wrong. Or perhaps going back to printing because the printer failed. So there's a lot of iteration in design. So the first course will be our 3D printing introduction course. So this will be 8 classes at 2 hours each, and it'll be targeted at grades 6 to 11. If you're in a younger grade than grade 6, you're still free to join the course. This is just a recommendation. So the first class will be an introduction to the printer. So we'll talk about the basics of printing and the parts of a printer. So, you know, what are all the moving parts? How does it work? What does it look like when a printer's doing something right? What does it look like when it's doing something wrong? What are the pieces that come together? Just, you know, basic knowledge of how a printer operates. Then class 2 will be a Cura introduction. So this is an introduction to the slicer. So how do we use the slicer? What are the settings? What's a raft? What's support material? What's the right way to slice a certain part? What's the wrong way to slice a certain part? Things to look for. For example, in a part like this, for example, support material is material that's inserted in as the print goes. Because when you're printing, let's say we print this part flat like this, the printer is going to print up and up and up and up and up, but then once it reaches the belly of the horse, unless there's material here, it's going to end up basically just going all over the place and your print's going to be, it's going to fail. It's going to get all messy and it'll look nothing like this. So knowing how to insert support material when you're slicing is important in order to have successful prints. And then we'll have slicer challenges. So we'll have different 3D part files, and I'll give that to the students. The students will then take those part files, they'll slice them, and then we'll see if they sliced it correctly and incorrectly. We'll print it out, see how it works, and then that's all part of the iteration. So how did we, what did we do correctly, what did we do wrong? We learn from our mistakes. And then we're going to do a Tinkercad intro. So Tinkercad is a very rudimentary CAD software. It's similar to that 2D, 3D. It's one of those CAD softwares that you can just pick up and make some really basic things really quickly. So it has a very low barrier of entry. That said, it's not something that you can use professionally. So if you were making a design for something like, for like a robot, if you're designing something for a robot, you wouldn't want to use Tinkercad. It's going to be very low quality and the prints will be inexact. So the Tinkercad is just so that they can get an idea of the full workflow from CAD to slice to print. So we'll do a quick Tinkercad intro on class 4, and then we'll give them some Tinkercad challenges. So they'll be challenged to make some simple Tinkercad parts, and then to slice those parts, and then to print them. And we'll have 2 classes of that, so the class 1 will probably be related to just, you know, doing the CAD and the slicing, and then class 6 will be related to how did our prints turn out, and then we're going to iterate back on it. And then the final exam, we'll tie this all together with a final part that they have to design, slice, and then print. And it will be similar to something that they would do with an actual CAD software. So the goal of this is not to have them, you know, out leaving the class and going off to an engineering firm and then, you know, designing parts. It's to give them some 3D printer proficiency so that they could have their own 3D printer. You could go in and purchase that 3D printer, bring it home. You'd know how to troubleshoot it, how to work with it, how to slice parts, how to download stuff from the internet, slice it and then print it, and they'd have some rudimentary CAD knowledge. So they know how CAD fits into the whole of 3D printing and how CAD softwares generally work. Not necessarily a professional grade CAD software, but a CAD software that's easy to use and free. Then the next class will be an advanced CAD course. So this is jumping from, this is building on the knowledge of 3D printing and how to 3D print, and we're going straight to advanced CAD. So we'll be using industry grade CAD software. This will be either something like SolidWorks or Inventor from Autodesk. And these are softwares that are used by engineers in the field and is used to design various parts. Most objects that you own are probably designed with one of these two CAD softwares, likely SolidWorks, possibly Inventor. And we'll be talking about sketching in the CAD software, assembling parts together, design techniques when we're designing parts, as well as simulation, because these advanced CAD softwares include simulation options. So let's say you designed a car, for example, in SolidWorks. You could simulate how air will flow over the body of the car. So we'll look at sort of those applications. And this may seem sort of out of the realm of what most students would be interested in doing, but it's very much within the realm, because when you're applying to universities and you're looking to getting into engineering, universities love it when you have knowledge of CAD. So they love it when they see SolidWorks and Inventor, because that's exactly what you'll be learning in university, and you'll have a jump on everyone else. So whether you're applying here in Canada or in the States, SolidWorks is a great asset, and it's also a lot of fun. Even though it is an advanced CAD software, it's very easy to pick up. I picked it up in grade 9, and it's very easy to get going. And it's a lot of fun once you figure it out, and it gives you a lot of ability to create advanced parts, to create advanced things like those that you see here, print them out, make your own things. It's a lot of freedom in that sense. And this also applies to robotics. We can print various parts for robots. As you may know, we have a VexIQ program here at the school. And custom parts for VexIQ can be printed, and this opens up a whole realm of possibilities for what can be created with robotics, and also just in general. So it's definitely a future asset, and one that looks great on a resume. So questions for either, I guess, myself or Henry?
Are you kidding? I mean, we don't have to sit over there and sit still.
Don't wanna pass the
person. Come over here, and then you can watch.
Yep.
And get this one running as well.
Yep.
So people can come over. And if you have any questions, just ask. Right.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Just so everyone knows, don't touch the printers. Like the ones that are on.
Yeah, it's actual hot during the printer. Yeah.
They're pretty hot. Don't touch them. Yeah.